Hello, everyone out there. Pink Lady here with Pink Lady Presents It Ain't Over Till You or I Say It's Over. Our guest today definitely proves that point. Welcome, William Mickey Stevenson, the A&R man to Berry Gordy's Motown labels. I am in awe. I mean, I'm sitting here right now, I'm like shaking because I'm in the presence, really, of a legend. And legend has nothing to do with age, everyone. It's who you are and what you've done with your life. When I say lives well lived, I mean that with all my heart with you, Mickey.
Oh,
I mean, just absolutely, you've done it all. Mickey, you help carve out those fabulous years for hundreds of black artists, like, name a few.
Stevie Wonder, Marvin Gaye, Four Tops.
I know.
Vandellas.
Supremes.
Supremes. I can keep going.
The Funk Brothers.
Funk Brothers.
Oh yeah, I mean, you can't forget the Funk Brothers. Yeah.
It's like a fairy tale coming true in America. I mean, you made it happen. Berry Gordy, God bless him, said Mickey was a street cat, a wheeler dealer, and it made him who he is. So you know what, everyone? We're going to show you a clip of what Berry Gordy and his friends have to say about our guest, Mickey Stevenson. Let's see what's going on.
As one of the architects of the sound of young America, he discovered musicians, he wrote hit songs, and he produced superstars. Mickey Stevenson, Motown's first A&R man.
Motown's 50th anniversary celebration was not about the stars. Diana, Stevie, Smokey, Lionel, The Temptations, etc. But about the people who made the stars. The unsung heroes. And Mickey Stevenson leads the list.
Mickey Stevenson is my brother. He has not received his props as someone who has contributed so much to the musical world. Mickey ended up becoming our first A&R director at Motown. Mickey went around to little clubs in Detroit and one by one gathered the guys who became the Funk Brothers.
The Funk Brothers created that unmistakable sound that launched a thousand hits.
And we did not make hit records to white people. We did not make hit records to black people. We made hit records for everybody on the planet.
I think about the time that I came to Motown, the producers, as one we have here tonight today, Mickey William Stevenson, who was one of the first people that I met when I came to Motown.
Yeah, Mickey!
Mickey was the one who convinced Marvin to start singing rhythm and blues. And he and Marvin wrote this song called Stubborn Kind of Fella. I guess it was probably about Marvin, because Marvin was a stubborn kind of fella.
Mickey turned out to be the greatest A&R man ever. He wrote, produced, brought in musicians like the Funk Brothers, brought my attention to Lil Stevie Wonder. He even brought in a pizza delivery guy who was a writer who wrote the biggest standard song we had, a song called For Once in My Life. His name was Ron Miller.
We were dedicated to getting the best out of those that we signed to this company. And that meant all of us. I'm talking about from the producers to the writers. We were working at our best to give them the best so they could be the best. It was a phenomenal feeling. It became a family-type feeling. That was, I guess that was part of the dream of Berry Gordy. We all bought into that dream.
Wow. You know, Mickey, when I look at that, I think of all the years that in growing up, we grew up with the music. Now, you had a birthday in January.
Uh-oh. Where's this going?
No, we're just saying you had a birthday in January, okay. And I had a birthday that's coming up in September. And you have to always listen to me because I'm your elder, okay? But you were in the Air Force.
Yes.
For how many years?
3.5 years.
And you, what were you doing? You were doing something in the entertainment unit?
I was handling the entertainment for different affairs that went on in the service.
Okay.
And I'd put, you know, shows together and things like that. And sometimes I made a mess and sometimes I had a great show. You know, our soldiers, sometimes they don't want to show up.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, well, now, after you toured when you left the service, mm-hmm. after you did that, you toured now with the Meadowlarks and Lionel Hampton. What was that about?
I was with the Meadowlarks.
Okay.
As a group, and in high school and all that stuff. And Smokey had his group, and we used to battle.
Oh, you know, I love it.
You know, when the parties came up for the school parties, well, he had his group, I had my group, and we were into it. It was a costume battle. Who was the best and who had the best songs?
I love it.
So we went from there to, when I came out of the service, I had, I thought that I was going to go right into the business and make a living, you know, it didn't work.
Right.
I mean, I didn't have the information, the knowledge, any of that, but I had the heart.
Yeah.
So I started singing with my old group, the Meadowlarks. And so what happened was, they had made a deal with the manager, to work with Lionel Hampton. But it came at a good time for me because I couldn't get into the business. I mean, I wanted to be in the business, but it wasn't happening. And they said to me, "We got this deal. We'd like for you to be one of the singers in the group." I said, "What happened to the other part? The other guy was singing." He said, "Well, he went with another group. And we can't get the job unless we come up with four guys."
Okay.
Oh. So I said, "Okay. Well, what kind of money are we going to make?" They say, "Man, don't worry about the money. Let's take the job."
Okay.
So I ended up with the Hamptones then.
Okay.
And we met Welton E. I'll never forget his name. Welton E. Barnett. Here's a guy would wear his coat over his shoulder.
Ooh.
Never put his arms into this. He had this
very drama.
Very drama. Oh, yeah. He was so dramatic. And his hat laid a certain way on his head. And he would say, when I first met him, he said, "I'm the manager. You will do what I say.
Ooh.
First thing you do is let me hear you sing and move."
Ooh.
So I said, "What is this?" You know what I mean? Anyway, I started a little song and I did a little movement around. He said, "Hold it right there." He said, "I know your mother was an artist, so a singer, so you should have some idea of what's going on in this business. And so, you know, when I speak, you know, you are supposed to obey." And I'm saying, what am I getting myself into here?
Yeah, what are you getting into?
And so the boys would be over the corner saying, don't say nothing. Because I had a habit of speaking right up. I would like something.
You were shy even then.
Yeah, right. At any rate, we made the deal, and we started. But I got to tell you, the knowledge that I acquired from that was fantastic.
Well, you learned, suppose that I tell the audience that you said something about, you learned about the musicians, their temperament, personality, insecurities, but you had to gain what you said, is their loyalty and their respect. How did you do that?
Well, I found that if you make a deal, even if it doesn't turn out right, if you made the deal, you got to honor that deal. You got to honor that statement, right. You know. And the greatest part about that is you get a lot of respect for that, mm-hmm. even if it didn't work.
Right.
And
you told it you from the heart. You meant it.
Right. And that was a lesson for me. So I wouldn't, if I didn't think I could make something happen, I wouldn't get into the deal with you. And that's taking you a little in advance. What happened was, after I learned this, watched this work, and I watched it when it didn't work, right, which is terrible. Because now you have people that don't like you, and then they spread rumors, and it always starts with a story like this, but it turns out
it's
a story
gigantic,
like this.
Right. How did you get that big? Yeah.
So I said, okay, no more of that. And I learned that if you don't get a feeling from the person immediately, watch it, because whatever that's resisting that is going to keep coming
that's
up.
Right. Something's there.
Yeah,
so that is your gut feeling in a lot of ways. Yeah, you were from that time when you went and you went on the a tour with the Hamptons and with Lionel Hampton and all that. But you were living, because I read it, like up above Denny's Show Bar.
Well, when I came back, when it was all over at the Hamptons, and I got to tell you, when Lionel's show closed, no more touring with him. We were kind of stuck in California,
right,
but nobody wanted to go home because, you know, we just wanted to keep going. And I took over the management of the group.
Ah, okay.
Because the guy who signed us up, the manager, he went left field. You know, he wanted all the money, everything. You know how that goes in this business.
Yeah, oh yeah.
But I learned a lot from him too. We used to go to the restaurants to eat breakfast, and we didn't have enough money because he kept most of the money. So we would get hot water and put some ketchup in it.
Tomato soup. Absolutely.
And make tomato soup.
Sure.
Get some crackers. And
Now
you had two choices. Either stop, get yourself a paper job or something.
Right.
Or keep going and try to figure out how you're going to get to some kind of career in this entertainment business.
Right.
And, of course, I was determined to keep going. But
I love that. But when I heard about Denny's, you know, you were up above a show bar.
Yes, yes.
And tell us about that, because that sounds like a lot of fun. Well, that was, like you said, 8 p.m. to 3 p.m. was the music there.
Yeah, well, I went into, had to get my own apartment, of course.
Right.
Do some separation with my wife and kids and business. So I had to take care of that and still survive. So I had a little apartment over the show bar. And at that time, I was working with musicians in the city. Now, what I did was, after learning about musicians with Lionel Hampton and the boys, I found that I could tell the good ones. Now, a lot of musicians could play, but they had a whole nother kind of attitude. Either they were,
right,
you know, supreme, dominant characters, or they were too humble, and they had this thing going up and down. But when they came to me because it started with one guy who had gotten paid for his job, but he got very little money. And the reason that the owner took the money from him was he would be late, he would be drinking, he would be eating up the food, and didn't want to pay for any of that. So when it came time to get paid, the manager just took the money out, didn't make the deduction.
Right.
Well, now he come to me to borrow a few dollars, and I said, man, you just got paid, what's your problem? He said, well, man, I can't pay my rent, Mick, and I got this deal, and I don't know what to do. I said, okay. I said, he wouldn't tell me what the problem was.
Well, no.
He just told me he needed more money. So right. I said, okay, I'll loan you the money, but let me go talk to your boss. He said, oh, yeah? I said, because something's wrong with this picture.
Yeah.
I went to the club, sat down with his boss, and the boss said to me, man, this guy's ridiculous. I said, well, why did you take the money from his feet? You got him here from 8 o'clock till 2 o'clock in the morning. He got to eat. Why would you not? You got food in there. Why would you not, you know, just give him a little something? And, you know, and he have a drink. Give him a little. He said, man, this guy won't come on time. He don't do this. He don't do that.
There's a reason.
There's a reason.
That's right.
So I said, I tell you what. Here's the deal. I will see to it that he's here on time. I will see to it that he does his job properly. You pay him. I say, now, in the meantime, you give him something to eat, since you got all this food,
right,
And you make sure that he has a drink or two, some wine, don't get crazy. And if anything goes wrong with it, I'll pay for it. And the guy said, well, what do you get out of this? I said, I want you to give me 10%.
There you go.
He said, 10% of what I'm paying him? I said, yeah, and anybody else that I bring in here to you. He said, you got a deal.
There you go.
So I went back to my buddy. I said, now here's the deal. I put my name on the line here.
That's
right. So now you be on time, blah, 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 blah. If you're not, I'm going to see that you get fired. And you're going to still owe me my money.
Right.
He said, what I owe you? I said, you got to give me 10%. So he said, okay. So that started it. But the bottom line is, Fig Lady, everybody, he would tell other musicians who would tell other musicians. All of a sudden, I got a crew of guys come in and say, okay, man, come talk to my man. Because they making it over there. The guy's right. Eating and they're having a good time and they're getting paid. And I said, okay. So to make a long story short, I learned and found out about the best guys in the city. So when I got with BG, with Barry, I could pick out the ones that would work with us.
Correct.
Even though we didn't have the funds at
That's
that
okay.
time.
But they knew your reputation.
But they knew my reputation. And I said, man, if it don't work, I'll pay for it.
There you go. But it was your word. You did before this, or during this, when did you do the satellite tour of the South?
The satellite tour?
It was called the Satellite Tour Southern Circuit.
Southern Circuit.
I'm going back.
Right.
Ladies and gentlemen, I go back. Oh, I want to find the history of where this man started.
I did that circuit with Bobby Day.
Yes, and you learned a lot.
Bobby Day and the Satellites.
Yep, yep.
Little pretty, pretty one,
there
come on,
go.
Talk to
right,
me.
Right.
Bobby Day, his manager, I can't think of his name at the moment.
And he said you learned a lot because of what was happening in America with the segregation in those days.
Oh, yeah, but that was before Motown.
Right.
I learned with Bobby Day. Remember I told you we got stuck in California when the tour was over?
Right.
Okay, now we got no work, and we're stuck. So we got us a little one-room apartment. It was one, it wasn't an apartment, just one room, and it had a piano in it and a bed that you pull out.
Yeah, Murphy bed.
Murphy, there it is. So we would, two would sleep, it was three of us now, three Hamptons. Two would sleep on the bed, one slept on the floor. And then we'd rotate. In the meantime, I'd go out and try to find some kind of gig as a group. Very difficult. But I ran into the guy who has, and his station is still on today. He has an R&B radio station.
Oh.
And I can't think of his name, but his station, he's gone, but the station still flows.
Right. Mm-hmm.
When you call in and say, I want this record and that record.
Yes, yes.
He had us do some background, because he was handling certain artists, some all pop artists, and he had us do background on one of his artists.
Oh.
And from that, Leon Rene, I think it was his name, that had Bobby Day,
right.
Was his manager and all that. He called us to do some background with Bobby Day. So that kind of gave us a little income.
Right.
Then he wanted us to go on the road. And I'm saying, I'm on the road. We never, we was on with, well, I don't have, that's a different kind of road.
Right.
This was like real road.
This was reality in
reality,
its best.
Reality, yeah. So I started with Bobby Day. And we went as Bobby Day and what was the name of his group? We had a name for that. It'll come to me. We went out as the group for Bobby Day, which, right. from the record. Mm-hmm. And that was a real tour. That was, sawdust on the floor, you come in, everybody's got the wine going in the days back, and it was incredible. But when Bobby Day started the song, Little Bitty Pretty One, Rockin' Robin,
right.
audience would go crazy.
Wow.
The key was, we didn't have a band. So when we get to the city, I'd have to find out who could play those songs.
That was a good job. Okay.
That was a whole other routine, yeah. right? And it worked out great. I mean, for some reason. But I learned a lot. I learned a lot about, the audience was right upon you. It wasn't like a great stage.
No. They were there.
Right in your face.
Yeah, right. Well, back to Denny's Bar, a show bar. The Beverly Mullins House of Styles.
Benny Mullins.
Now that Benny, I'm saying, right, okay, Beverly, no, Benny, I get it. Okay, so that's where you met Berry Gordy.
Yes.
Tell us about that.
Benny Mullins. Benny Mullins was a barber who processed hair. We all had that whole thing going with the waves. And Benny Mullins could make waves in your head that you could put a boat on. He was the best. And so all the entertainers that came into Detroit to perform, from Jackie Wilson on, they would all go to Benny Mullins to get their hair taken care of. And so I'm there having mine taken care of. Berry Gordy's having his. Now, Benny Mullins would keep but find things for people to do because he only had two chairs in the shop. So he'd have to have some chess playing over here, checkers over there, phone calls over here. Everybody's doing something. And he kept you in the shop right, while he could keep you there to get that money, right? So Barry's in one chair getting his hair processed. I'm in the other chair with the oil on mine waiting to get mine processed. And so Benny would say, hey, Barry, this is the guy I was telling you about, Mickey Stevenson. Now, this guy's man, he knows all the musicians and everything in the city, and he's a writer. And he said, now Barry, to me, he said, now, you know, Barry wrote that song that you love by Jackie Wilson. I said, what? I said, you wrote that song, Barry? He said, yeah. I said, you producing him? He said, yeah. I said, I got a couple of songs.
I love it.
So he said, so that's how we got hooked up. He wouldn't take my songs, but we got really into a deep dialogue. And he said, man, when I come back from, I'm going in to finish up an album in Chicago. So when I come back, we got to have a talk. And I said, okay, man, whatever you want.
Yeah.
And then what happened was, now you got to go under the dryer. You know, when you get your hair done, you got to go. We landed in the dryer, and I'm dreaming because I'm saying to myself, uh-oh, this is it. I'm going to be a star. I'm going to be the next. I'm going to be the next Jackie Wilson.
No, that's why when I was reading this, because now we're going to go ahead a little time, and you were with Smokey on the golf course, and the call came in that Berry Gordy wanted to see you. And then you went to his apartment.
Yeah.
Quote, unquote. Tell our audience about the apartment and what went on there.
I get this call for Berry to meet him at his apartment.
Right.
So I said, okay, this is it. I'm
going to
be
apartment.
A
star. Yeah.
Plus, I'm going to be a star. I'm going to be the next Jackie Wilson.
There you go.
So I go in to his apartment. Well, I go to the apartment building.
Yeah.
And he lived in what we called a ghetto fabulous apartment building. Now, ghetto fabulous means nothing works. You know what I mean? You push the doorbell, yeah. Nothing happens. You can't get in. You got to wait till somebody's coming out before you can get in. So I said, man, this is Berry Gordy. I'm walking in this down the hall to his apartment, the door. And I'm looking around. I said, man, that guy's got two great records on Jackie Wilson. So anyway, I get to the door. I'm getting ready to knock on the door. He opens the door with his shorts on, home phone in his hand. He said, okay, what's up? What's up? I said, he said, oh, Mickey, come on in. And he said, I'll be right with you. And he's talking. I'm talking about seriously talking. And then he said, you got your songs with you? I said, yeah. He said, okay. Let me hear a couple of them. He put the phone, he finally puts the phone down.
I love the next
I'm looking
thing.
Around. I don't see no piano. Curtains half messed off on the windows, messed up and everything. And I'm saying, is this Berry Gordy? I mean, this guy. And I said, okay, let me do my songs
right.
Anyway.
Oh, yeah, waiting for that. Yeah.
I can't forget that. You got Jackie Wilson, number one. All right, so I sang a couple of songs.
And then?
And he said, you got any more? I said, yeah. Oh. He said, okay, let me hear them. I said, oh, this is it. Now I'm going to pull out my big one now.
I
said, this is the song that's going to make me a star. And I sang this to him. If only the sky was a mirror. And I do the whole song. And Barry said, okay, he said, that's a pretty good song. I said, now for my follow-up, he said, hold on. Follow-up? I ain't call you to do no recording.
No.
He said, your songs are pretty good, but your voice is for shit.
I love it.
I said, love what?
It. Yeah. Oh, yeah, my Lord.
I'm ready to get out of there.
Oh, I love. No, but then, wait a minute. He offered you a job.
Well, because I was ready to go.
Right.
And he said, where you going? I said, man, I come to be an artist.
Yeah, well, yeah.
He said, oh, I come for you to be the A&R man for my new company. I said, what is that? He said, A&R. You get artists and musicians and
bring them together.
Put them together. We make records. We make hit records, though. In other words, I would be a hit record artist.
I'd be a hit record maker.
Yeah.
I love it. I love it. Well, when I read that, and then, I mean, you got this fabulous offer of $5 a day.
$5
I want you to
day.
Hear this. $25 a week. I mean, like, wow. And wait a minute, that's not enough. You also got a bowl of chili, all you could eat.
All the chili.
All you could eat. That was the important thing.
Without the meat.
Without the meat. And then you took it.
Yeah, I took it because, first I was going to leave. I said, this is ridiculous. I'm walking away. And I remember my mom said to me, if you want to get into something, you got to take a step.
There you go.
If you don't
one
make
step.
A move, it ain't going to happen.
Right.
And it's not always wonderful to start with.
There you go.
It's but it's a start.
That's
but,
right.
But it's a start. So I turned around and walked back to him. I said, when do I start? He said, you already did.
You already did. I love it.
Which was my first sign to me that other than a writer, Berry Gordy, he had a gift.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did. And he also said, if I remember correctly, in the first four bars, I can tell whether that song's going to make it or not. I mean, that is a gift from God, Mickey.
Yes,
it just
yes.
says. And speaking of the gifts and things like that, we're going to hear during the course of this talking with you some of the songs that were made everybody get up and move and shake. Jimmy Ruffin's song, What Becomes of the Brokenhearted? Let's hear that, audience. I know you're going to know this one. Yeah. Oh, Mickey, yeah.
As I walk this land of broken dreams, I have visions of many things, but happiness is just an illusion filled with sadness and confusion. What becomes of the broken hearted? Who has love that's now departed?
I mean, I have to tell you, if I can come back, I want to come back as a singer. I always loved to sing, and I don't know, C from Ave or whatever it is from notes there, but I love that song.
When I'm conducting services, I get to sing all I want, except they don't let me turn the microphone on.
That's it. Now, as an A&R man, you said you had to be a father, a therapist, a brother, a best friend, a mentor, and you had to groom them and what works for them. And you said, you build the structure around the person rather than fitting the person around the structure. Tell me about that.
Well, every artist, they had personal problems.
Yeah.
They had, of course, the desire to be an artist. Mm-hmm.
Right.
And those things, along with their whatever upbringing they had, you know, fathers, mothers, cousins, aunts, whatever, there was someone in that group that they had a lot of confidence in, and a lot of people in that group that would try to pull them down.
Right.
Now, when they came in to be an artist with us, first I had to find out what field that they may come in as a singer, but to me they were better as a writer. They may come in as a writer, but they had a great voice, better as a singer. So my job was to put another confident, reach another place in them so they'd be confident that they could be whatever it is.
Secure in themselves and what they were doing, right.
To that, it's not easy because now you got to know the person and the person's got to believe and have faith in you.
There you go.
So now, if I found that this guy needed a brother friend, I would be a brother friend with him,
right.
You know, and we'd talk about his problems and I'd talk like his brother. And from that point of view, if I found as a father thing, not a father thing, but a cousin, if I found it was a whatever was missing that I felt was missing.
That you were that person.
I would become
there
that person. So that they would give me some truth and some reality and I could reach them and tell them what they needed to know that would help us grow.
Right. Mm-hmm. And build their inner security.
Yes, yes. Yeah. And now how I learned to do that is obviously a gift from God.
Yes, it is.
I'm not some fantastic guy that was Svengali or something. I was given the gift to reach out and touch the person where they needed to have.
Well, you had a gut feeling for that.
Yeah.
And which a lot of people don't have.
Yeah. And so they would, and it cost me because they would call me now at any hour when that problem came up. I get a call at 2 o'clock in the morning.
Oh, no.
Hey, Weimar, let me tell you what happened.
Oh.
You know, and
it, I had
sometimes
a fight with my girlfriend.
And, sometimes it'd be drastic, and I'd say, okay, man, why don't you just meet me at the coffee shop on such and such?
Wow.
Let's straighten it up because you sound drastic, and you got a session tomorrow, and we got to finish this album,
right,
and you're not
going
to finish it with that all in your head.
That's right.
So I'd find myself getting up, putting on a hat or something because I ain't going through no hair combing and stuff. I was some tennis shoes and meet him at the shop or meet him someplace or her.
But now you were not Mickey Stevenson. You were Dr. Mickey Stevenson because you were like a psychiatrist as well.
Yeah, and I got to tell you, it was so amazing that before it was over, they would do great product. Yes. They would do great stuff. And Barry would say, how'd you get him to do that? I'd say, you don't want to know.
Yeah, you don't want to know. I love this. Now, you found, because every great artist has to have a studio band, how did you find the Funk Brothers? I mean, you went to places I heard that were kind of,
I would go anywhere. I would go anywhere. I had no... I don't care where, if I heard a guy was great in that spot,
yes, you went.
I would go. Yeah. And sometimes it would be a frightening place to go into because you might get your head knocked off, but I would go anyway.
Right.
Because I was determined to get the best players I could get. Now, you remember, before, I knew a lot of good players because I helped them.
Right.
So I had my hands on a couple the moment I took over the job that I could get my hands on right away. And then I would have them tell others that I'm looking.
Ah. Well, were the Funk Brothers, they were a band already, or did you put them together?
They were all individual guys.
Oh, wow, Mickey.
I brought them
in
one at a time.
Wow.
One at a time. And
how long were they with Motown? Quite a while.
Once we teamed up, they stayed until forever.
Wow.
They were.
I think right now we're ready for, I love this group, the Four Tops Ask the Lonely. Love that song. Love it.
Make it all alone. Remember, no one is big enough to go alone. Just ask the lonely. They know.
I tell you, every time we hear the music from before, it's still now. Oh. It doesn't matter. There's no time to that music. Do you know what I'm saying? Yeah. That's what is so fabulous, Mickey. The white agencies, quote unquote, had no interest at that time in black artists. Why? That's what I just didn't get in my head. Why?
Well,
were they sleeping? I mean, God.
They weren't sleeping. They just, it was a prejudice thing.
Yeah.
And we got some of that going on today, which is crazy.
Yeah.
Fortunately, the music passed that line.
Okay, right.
You know, the music reached the hearts of people.
Yes.
And there's no color with that.
Right.
And even today, I've had friends say to me, through the 60s program, and they said, oh, man, the music. My white friends, shall we say, said to me, and they're like brothers to me, my friends are. And they said to me, man, when I was growing up listening to that music, I would have to go home at night. I had to get in to put the cover over my head and play the tapes because if my parents heard me listen to that Motown music and stuff, they'd go crazy. But I couldn't stop listening to that music. I knew all the songs, and they would know the songs. They knew the lyrics, so there was no color to music. And they said, but this black thing can't be what they say, and yet you make music like this. Something wrong with this picture. I'm sure it's glad I stayed with it like that. But I got to tell you about the Four Tops. When I was on furlough, I went to the Warfield Theater. That was our Apollo in Detroit.
Right.
And the Four Tops, Jackie Wilson, and somebody else was there. But they had an amateur show. And the amateur show, the Four Tops weren't known as the Four Tops then. They were called the Four Ames.
Oh, okay.
And they had this amateur show going on. And I'm sitting there watching the show, and they had three or four acts come on, terrible. When the Four Ames, alias Four Tops, come on, they started singing, and they did a song called, they took R&B, jazz, and a heavy blues thing and put it all in one song. And they would go, do-do-do-da-do-da-da, what? And they make those harmonies. I said, man, these guys are great. Of course, they won the contest, but that was one of the main things that made me say to myself, I'm not going to stay in the Army. I'm going in the show business. And I said, one day these guys are going to be stars.
Wow.
That was then, right?
Yeah.
Years later, after I got with Barry, with the Motown thing, I'm in New York, and I'm doing jazz. Barry said to me, we need a jazz label. I said, come on, BG, jazz. Less than 10% of the market. You know, we're doing great. He said, I want a jazz label. You the NMRN? I said, yeah. He said,
get it. Just get it. I can hear him.
That's it. Exactly. I said, okay. So I go into New York, and I'm working with all the jazz musicians that are cutting this album. And, you know, and the problem with that in those days, jazz musicians wouldn't stay with one label.
Oh.
They would do an album with you, and then you'd do one with you, and they would kind of mix it up. So you couldn't build them that way. Their names would go, but you couldn't, you know, build an artist like that. Not like we were trying to do at Motown. So I said, okay, I am going to get me a singer, like a Nancy Wilson, and then build her with the jazz, blah, 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 right? So that was that part. So I said to Barry, okay, BG, I'm coming out of New York. This ain't happening. And he said, okay. And I said, so this is my last day there. I stopped by a club, and Billy Eckstein is singing.
I
said, okay, B, his opening act was the Four Tops.
Oh, that's funny.
But I didn't know that because I saw Four Tops, and the group I knew was the Four Ames, remember?
Oh, that's funny.
So I'm sitting down there waiting, and it's this group walk on, but I remember the guys, and they started singing. I said, oh, my God, that's the group. And they sang. I told the owner of the place, I said, hey, those guys come over here as soon as they get off. He then came over to my table. I said, hey, man, you guys were the Four Tops in Detroit. The Four Ames, now you're the Four Tops. I said, you got to come back to Detroit, sign with me, I'll make you stars.
Oh, my, and?
They looked at me like I was crazy. I said, man, what are you talking about? We sang jazz. I said, you sang music. I said, and one of your best songs that I remember was, and I sang the tune that they
no
did
because
it never left my head.
I love it.
Do-do-do-do-da-do-da-da.
I started singing. Crazy.
And so they start singing with me. Now, we're in the club now. I'm singing, they're singing. And I said, now, you coming to Detroit? I'll sign you up and make you stars. And the guy said, man, y'all just got to go back on, the owner. And so I said, okay, I'll see you in Detroit. So I got up, and I said, do-do-do-do-da-do-da-da. And they said, do-do-do-da-do-da-da. And we da-da-da. I'm walking out the door. We left, right?
Oh.
They came home 2 weeks later. Duke and the Fort Pops knocked on my door at the office. And they said, okay.
We're here.
What about this stuff thing you're
going
to do with
us?
I said, no problem. We had a short conversation. I reached in my drawer, pulled out 4 contracts, because I kept all the contracts in my drawer. Put the contracts on the table. I say, you can take them. I say, take them to your lawyer, whatever you want to do. I'm going to tell you right now, I ain't changing shit.
This is it.
This is it. So, but I will make you stars. They took the contracts, went out the door. About 20 minutes later,
they came back in.
They walked up in, they said, give me a pen. So I said, you want to let your lawyer read it? They said, you said you was going to make the stars. That's all we got.
That's right.
You got it.
That's right. Your word.
And I can tell they wasn't playing either. You know? I take them over to the side. I take them over to the studio area. All the boys, Holland, Doge, everybody hanging around. And so Barry say, man, you got us another group? I say, hold it, BG. I say, Levi, sing a song. He said, what song? I say, sing anything. Levi started singing. Barry said, wow. Holland, Doge say, excuse me. Everybody ran to their rooms to start writing.
Oh, wow.
Now, was this Levi Strauss?
Levi Stubbs.
Stubbs.
The lead of the Fort.
And I saw him in Little Shop of Horrors.
Yep.
He was Audrey to the plant.
Oh. Yeah, he was the plant.
Right.
He was the plant.
I never forget that voice.
Yeah.
Well, we're going to stop for a moment because we're going to go into Marvin Gaye, Kim Weston with It Takes Two.
Oh.
I know, I love these things. I'm having a ball.
One can have a dream, baby. Two can make that dream so real. One can talk about being in love. Two can say how it really feels. One can worship on a star. Two can make that wish come true. One can stand alone in the dark. Two can make the light shine through. It takes two, baby. It takes two, baby. Me and you. Just takes two.
Oh, my. I'm getting exhausted here. I'm like dancing over here. It's a way to hear another one with dancing.
You know, one of the things I wanted to share with you is I was in the service during the Vietnam War, 62 to 65. I went in, 62 came out in 68. But 3 of those years I was in Europe. And I had 8 bases in France, Spain, Morocco, Libya, and Germany. And it didn't matter where I went. If it was the NCO club, the officers club, wherever it was, this was the music. This was whatever was going on. It's what's going on. And I can remember it really fondly because there were always people who were in service who played piano, and they would get up there and start playing along with whatever was recorded. And everyone would stand and start moving and grooving, and it was, I mean, it was just amazing to see what was going on.
Well,
there was no color line
right.
in the Air Force. There was no color line in the Navy, in the Marines. They were fellow soldiers.
Yes.
And they loved music, good music. And that's what Motown was all about.
But great. Every good thing comes to ends, as we all know. What was the beginning of the end with HGH producers of Motown? What was that? I mean, in other words, you ended your relationship after how many years with Barry?
About nine, somewhere in there.
And then where did you go from there? And what, I mean, you went to Columbia. I mean, what was that all about? What happened
well,
there?
I thought I had reached my limit.
Okay.
And I wanted to stretch out on my own.
Well, you used the word, it was my time to use my wings and take flight. I love that.
Yeah.
Just love that.
It was time. Because re-signing for a new contract,
right.
And I could see myself being still at one place.
Not going anywhere.
Not going anywhere.
Right.
And,
right. So you started your own production company at
Well,
that
I
time?
Got with MGM offered me a deal.
Okay.
To start, they wanted me to build another Motown. I told them, that's not going to happen.
No.
Motown was set for a purpose from the man upstairs for
yes,
a reason.
Thank you. Right.
And so there, and that reason was on and it was happening. Now, that went for any of us at the company, those who felt that they should move,
yeah.
That they had done what they were here to do.
Correct.
This is
right.
my looking at it now. Like right. that they own. So I set out with Clarence Avant. And he said, man, well, they want you to build another Motown. That, you know, you, the A&R man, you can do the same kind of job. I said, not going to happen the same way. Those artists walked in and came in, and we found them out of the grace of God. That's not going to happen. It's a possibility, but it won't be the same. That's one thing. I can build another label
yes,
if that's
you
what
go.
You want.
There you go.
And so they said, well, they were still thinking Motown.
Yeah.
I thought that was what they were thinking. At any rate, I met with MGM, and I told Barry, of course, that, you know, I said, listen, I would like to stay, but I'd like a piece of the company, you know, so I have a future.
Future.
And we couldn't agree to that level. But he said to me, wherever you go and whatever you do, if you need anything from me, you just call me.
Wow.
And his word has never been different. Than that.
I love that.
And I have made some calls to him, and he did exactly what he said he would do.
Love it.
But to move on, I made this deal with MGM, and which was a strange, the whole thing was strange. Kim Weston, who was my wife at the time,
uh-huh.
She, of course, left when I left.
Right.
That was right in the middle of Takes Two, the song. And she went with Harry Belafonte on a tour. Because
oh,
she was it was a great combination.
Yeah.
She would open for Harry Belafonte. I'm now with MGM, and we opened this label called, can't remember. At any rate, we opened the line, and what happened was I found out through Harry on a tour with Kim that the label was not really, the label that they opened with me was not really the purpose. They were bringing me in with the Motown buildup
right.
to sell more stock. And then they really closed the label, MGM,
ooh.
And they built the MGM Grand Hotel.
Okay.
That was incredible.
Wow.
And that's when I first had an eye on what, you know, stock was and, you know, with companies.
Right,
and that whole world is a whole nother ballgame.
Mm-hmm.
To me, it was like it has nothing to do with the heart of the people that you're dealing with.
No.
It's only about the money.
Thank you. Chips.
Ah.
Chips. And before we go in, because I know this is a great story, before we go any further, when you started your own production company, recording studio, you had like Tina Turner.
Yeah, Tina Turner was, she was one of the artists that used my studio,
uh-huh.
her and her husband. And man, they would come in and book the whole place.
Love it.
And they would stay there, and I watched Tina work. And it would give me a whole nother energy about artists. She was nonstop.
Well, she was energy personified.
She was unbelievable. And I had a refrigerator in the studio in the back, right? And I had like some wine in there and juices and all that. Every time they come to the studio, everything would be missing when I come back. I say, wait a minute, can't y'all replace the stuff? They say, we were at the studio, that goes for everything in it.
I love it. Now, you also got a nominee for Best Score title in the movie Changes.
Yes.
I mean, so you're not just a pretty face, Mickey. I mean, you're just all over the place here. And then you got an NAACP Image Award. I mean, you've been doing okay. Now, I want to get to Inner City Cultural Center.
Yes.
Tell me all about that.
While I was in California, I left Motown now. I'm in Los Angeles.
Right.
And I'm doing my thing at the studio, my own studio. And I'm producing people like Johnny Nash and people like that. Cliff Rockmore from Detroit was teaching classes at Inner City Cultural Center. That was where people had to go. They didn't have to go, but opportunity to learn about acting and singing and dancing. And they took students. You didn't have to have any money. It was financed by the city, but they had special people there to help them develop and grow and get them off the street. And it was a wonderful, wonderful place for them. And Cliff, being a Detroit boy, knew I was in L.A. He said, man, you got to come by and speak to the students here. They would love to hear from you from Motown and all that, man.
Yeah.
And I said, well, what can I say to them? Just tell them something about how you guys did the records and give them some inspiration and all that. So he was so persuasive. I said, okay, I'll come by for a few minutes, man. He said, okay. So I went by, and I saw all these different classrooms. They had dancers in this gym. They had another kind of dance thing going here. They had actors upstairs. They had writers. I said, wow. They had two theaters in the place. One held about 90 seats. The other held about 45 seats. And I said, man, this is incredible. And I see all these kids, black, white, Hispanic, some, and adults. They were there just trying to move their lives,
right,
you know.
Right.
And so I said, okay. They brought them into the main theater, and I said a few words and talked, and they asked me 1,000 questions. And but I saw the sincerity and I saw the hurt and the hunger, and it kept me talking, and it went on for a long time. So it was over. And then one of the students walked up to me and he said, you know, we're doing a play here. And could you write a song for our show? And I said, well, I don't write show songs. I write R&B songs. And they said, well, any song would be great for our show. Just to know that you...
Right.
So I said, okay, let me see the show. So they did a run-through of the show and all that. And they came to a spot. So Cliff said, man, that's a good spot to put a song in right there. So I said, okay, but why would I write a song about what they're saying? I said, I tell you what, I'll take what they're saying and put the song in, and you don't have to say that. Y'all can move on with the show. So I said, okay. So we got together. So Cliff and I, the director, we got to the moment. I wrote the song. We put it together. We put it into the show. People went crazy. Mickey Stevenson song, and it was a gift to them. You know, I was just doing it. And when it was over, they came back to say, now we're doing another show. Could you write
I love it.
Could you write a song for the show? So I said, well, wait a minute. You know, he said, well, we'll do anything you want.
Aww.
I said, okay. I'll do one more song. And so I did another song for them. And in the process of that now, I'm beginning to feel the same feeling that we had at Motown, this
something,
something was happening here. And so I would come back and forth and back and forth, see how I was handling my song.
Right.
I was saying it to myself, but I was really being led back there.
That's right.
Because I was helping those kids do other things now, and the adults that were there. And one day, Cliff would say, man, why don't you write a show and do more of, I said, well, I don't know how to write a show. He said, it's like you're writing your songs.
That's right.
He said, I will help you.
Yeah.
Now, he was very good, right?
Yeah.
So I said, okay. So now I'm taking lessons from him how to write a show. And we wrote this show called Swan. Swan was about Marvin Gaye and Jackie. I made them all one person because I knew them and their personalities. And I had Forrest Whitaker, who was an acting studying at that time and studying. And 4 or 5 people that became big artists today started with my shows.
Lynn Whitfield.
And That guy is doing a commercial now forever about for your car. I can't think of his name. It was amazing. But I started working with him because I could pick the artists, the actors, from the same way that I would pick the artists. So that was almost a natural flow.
Correct.
But to put him in a show, I had to have a director like a Kim, like a, my director was working with me, Cliff Rockmore, to show me
how to do it.
At any rate, it went on and on, and it was really growing great. And it got to the point that we would have a show run for maybe 2 months. Audience would come from all over. And we went into some really unique ones.
Well, you did The Gospel.
The Gospel Truth.
And then you did Wings and Things.
Wings and Things.
I love these names.
They're really amazing.
Well, speaking of names, we have a song coming up now called Devil with the Blue Dress On, Mitch Ryder. So we're going to hear that. I love that name, Devil with the Blue Dress On. We're going to make it the pink dress.
Another song.
Another song.
Here she come, wearing a wig hat and shades to match. Got her high-heeled shoes and an alligator hat. Wearing a pearl and a diamond ring. Got bracelets on her finger and
everything.
Devil with a blue dress, blue dress.
I'm moving and grooving over here. I love this. Now, fabulous. Who was that song about?
To make that clear, I got to tell you about my partner who wrote the
song. Okay, I'm ready.
His name was Shorty Long.
Okay.
Shorty Long had to be about this tall. Okay?
Right.
Shorty Long's, when he sat at the piano, his foot could not reach the pedal.
I love it.
So he had to kind of ease down there and play the piano. Shorty Long loved tall, beautiful girls.
Okay.
Now, can you imagine? He's here, and the girls are way up there.
I love it.
And he said, oh, man, how about this idea right here? And he was playing this groove to Devil with the Blue Dress. So we wrote that song together.
I love it.
And I could see the girls that Shorty was in love with by the way he would get into this song. So the song came, and he really, I mean, he was gone.
Oh,
I mean, when they tall and fine, he was just out there. They could just pick him up like this camera.
I love it. Oh, my Lord.
So that's what the song was all about, and that's where it came from. And it was a fun thing to write, and to hear him sing it was also fun.
It was also funny. Wow.
And is he still alive? Is he still
no, he Shorty passed.
Well, let me ask you a question. Why a pseudonym name, Avery Vandenberg, for some of Jovette's, I mean, why did you pick that? I mean, I'm like reading about it, I'm going, wait a minute, Avery Vandenberg? I mean, hello? I'm waiting for a man with a cravat here, you know, and all that stuff. I mean, what was that about?
Well, we opened a company, Barry did, another publishing company. We had Jovette Music.
Right.
And then he opened another company. And he put this one with ASCAP. Now we had two companies. Now, as you know, back in the days, publishing companies and everybody else was a very prejudiced situation, no matter what. And it's sort of, it was in that bit part of the business as well. And when I found Ron Milner, who did For Once in My Life, which is a whole nother story. It put us in another place of music. So, and I enjoyed that place because that's where I would play and shows, that's part of my feeling. So we changed our names for writers, Smokey, myself, and others, so that we would fit the white quote
the image
that came out of here.
Love it. Oh, my goodness. So yes.
And the name of the company was called Stein and Van Stock.
Woo. Okay.
You know what I mean? We could have called it a soulful name, but that wasn't going to work going into.
Sure.
Right. Love it.
And so I became Avery Vandenberg.
Love it.
And every time, and I tell my brother, I say, okay, now, when they write in, they'll write to your address. And every time they wanted us to come in and receive something, we couldn't show up because they the name of it.
Oh, my, I love that story. I now want to stop, and I want to go to one of my favorites, which is Stevie Wonder's Uptight. Everything is all right. I'm ready. Okay. I love it. Woo, that is a good one. I don't blame you for doing that. It's like moving and grooving over there.
Work me up.
I am. There is, and I know this is going to make you laugh and think about this. There was a song that you wrote called Here I Am. Mm. And I know that everyone out there wants to hear it. But they're going to hear it. But could you kind of just sing a couple of bars of it? Here I am.
Here I am, born to love you with all of my heart. Oh, God.
I know. Can we hear that song, please? Here I am.
Oh. Here I am. Born to love you with all of my heart. I give myself completely, hoping you will treat me with love and care. I need you, I swear, darling, here I am. Here I'll be forever if you will need me. No ties to bind you, just let me stand beside you. I want you free, just love me. You can go anywhere, darling.
I love it. I love your voice. Wow. I don't care what Barry Gordy said about your voice. Hello, Barry Gordy. I don't care what you said. He's good. You know, Mickey said, the world of entertainment is a game. It's a game with a purpose. The game is to have fun and enjoy yourself. The purpose is to diligently pursue your dream. Mickey, you have done that. You have pursued a dream that others could only think about, not even do. But you did it because you not only had the smarts, quote unquote, to do it. But you had the heart to do it. What your mother said was right. That if you have a dream, you go with it. Because there's no one, if you really believe in it, no one should try to take it off your mind. Yeah. And you followed your way with it. And you're also now doing some things.
Oh, yeah.
Do you have the book for me, honey?
Yes.
I just read this and reread it, marked all the lines. I mean, it's all pink pencil, everybody. The book is called Motown's First A&R Man Presents the A&R Man Himself. And it's filled with honesty. I have to tell you, in reading this, you were honest about your faux pas, your mistakes, and you were truthful to the people who depended on you to get them out there. And that's why how do we get this book?
Oh, it's on Amazon.
On Amazon.
Or you can go to my site.
What's
William
your site?
Mickey Stevenson. Okay. And my website, William Mickey Stevenson.
William Mickey Stevenson.
.com.
Yeah.
Okay, everyone? Yeah. Because let me tell you, it is worthwhile. Because when you start to pick this up, you're going to learn about the history of where real music came from. There's one of my favorite songs that was written among many, many songs. And it's called, I love this. I'm going to get up and dance. It's called Dancing in the Streets with Martha and the Vandellas. Let's hear that one. The story.
Okay.
This is so cute.
Couple of things. First of all, 1986, I was in a Boston hotel in Cambridge on the Charles River, and I'm getting ready to do a radio show with Larry Glick the next night. I had all my notes spread all over, and an ad came on television. I had it very softly in the background, and it said, Dancing in the Streets, the musical, tonight. Closing night. And I said, I gotta go. And I pushed all the papers aside. I got out of bed, got dressed, went over to the theater. I said, I just hope you have a ticket because I want in. And they said, well, sure. And so they bought a ticket. The place was packed. They start doing the musical. And when they get to Dancing in the Streets, they do the song. And then they lead four or five people come out, and they're on the edge of the stage, and they said, have you had enough dancing in the streets? And everyone yelled, no! and they had a live band. They said, follow us. And they started dancing up the aisle, out the front door to Tremont Street, around Washington Street, back into the theater, and we're all dancing in the streets. Okay. Something I never forgot. I got a chance to see it firsthand. The other thing that I get to do, and I know we both served in the Air Force at about the same time, I have the privilege of being the president of the Los Angeles National Cemetery Foundation. And we, for the first time, have done something that we have never done in 100 years, and that is we developed a challenge coin to commemorate the 88,800 American heroes that are interred in our cemetery. And it gives me tremendous pleasure and honor to present you, Mickey Stevenson, with one of our challenge coins from the Los Angeles National Cemetery Foundation, where, by the way, as I said, we have 88,800 graves. Starting this fall of 2019, we're doubling capacity with 90,000 more niches for 90,000 cremated remains of veterans. We'll be handling it for 25 or so funerals every day, starting in the fall. And I'm going to invite you to come to the columbarium opening, where everybody will have 2,000 very important people honoring our American heroes. So on behalf of the board of directors and our director, Tom Ruck, thank you for all you've done for our military, not only serving, but making sure that our veterans and our active duty are included in everything you do. Thank you.
Thank you. Wonderful.
And Mickey, your saying and my saying in a particular thing just goes together. If you can dream and believe it, you can do it. But like they say out there, it ain't over till I say it's over. And Mickey, it's not over till you say it's over, and it's not over. Tell us what you're doing now.
I am doing a musical called Les Gemmes, The Jewel. And it's about women, four women, and with that musical, I want to inspire them, or keep on inspiring them, because they're on a move now, which is fantastic.
Right.
And I want to keep on with that, let them know that it's wonderful. And I have five daughters, so I really want them to feel that they can do anything they want to do.
We're going to show everybody a little bit of a tease about the gems right now.
Les Gemmes, Mesmerizing Showgirls. That's the name of this marvelous, wonderful production, musical play that I'm working on right now. And the music is not only by myself, but also novel, four-time Grammy Award winning writer. And the story, Les Gemmes, Mesmerizing Showgirls, is about nine young talented girls that were brought to the theater to work with Ethel, who was a superstar, had a problem, and was pushed out of the business for a while. Her comeback was to put this presentation together and make it work. Now, it sounds easy, but each girl has problems and confusion and confrontations of their own. They got to work through that and still produce the product. And they have about 7 weeks to make this work. And they pull it off. But from the beginning to the end, the story is told about their lives. It's fantastic. I was inspired to do this show because of my daughter, Ashley, who passed, and my experiences with the ladies at Motown and the problems. As a matter of fact, some of the characters in the show are designed from some of the problems that I went through at Motown with the women. I could actually put faces on the names. I think it's a woman's time, and this show really makes it very important. This show is part of that understanding and pushing the buttons to wake people up and give them the respect that they deserve.
Another audition, look like a guarantee. You're in the position, now we gotta wait and see. Your hopes are riding high as you fly.
with this show, I'd like to leave the audience and mainly the young people with the idea that they can do anything they want to do. They just have to stay focused, believe in it, don't take no for an answer, and make it happen. It's going to cost you, but it's all worth it. Anything worthwhile, if it doesn't cost you anything, is not worthwhile doing. Know that. I want them to learn that and see that and believe in that. This is an example for them. Showgirls Legion. Oh, I love that title.
Wow, I want to buy a ticket now. So when do you think that will come into fruition? When we
Well, I'm working with it. Okay. The different ladies' organizations are contacting me.
Good.
They like it.
Good.
And I would say I've got a few months.
Good,
you know,
great.
But I love the idea that they're calling me and they want to have the song, might even be part of their whole movement.
Well, mm-hmm. I like the idea that you haven't stopped, Mickey. You see, my whole thing is that it doesn't matter what age we are. We are who we are at any age. I mean, like, hello. I say that in all respect to you know who. Thank
yes.
you for giving me into my 87th year and 88th and 9 and 90. But I want to be sitting in the audience all these next years when you are doing your thing and your plays and all that. Barry Gordy said, Mickey Stevenson is definitely one of Motown's unsung heroes. And it's true, but you learned something. And this is what I love when you said, after a lot of years, God loves me. Better late than never. And I'm still learning.
Still
what do you
learning.
Mean by that, my darling?
I'm still learning because He keeps giving me things to do.
Yes.
And in doing the things that I'm doing now, the knowledge that was given me, it all comes up right. to this point, which means there's even more to
yes.
do. And if I keep acknowledging the fact that it comes from God,
yes.
I can keep going.
And
you are a shining example.
Thank
of God's
you.
Gifts, too. You
I
are amazing.
You. I thank you so very kind. Just if I had a voice, then I would have gone to you years ago. I
and
tell
been,
you.
Been a superstar
a
then.
A superstar then, you know? But we're going to hear a song that you're promoting now with a young lady called What If a Lady Is... Tell me about the song with the White House.
Put a woman in the
Put
White
a
House.
Put a woman in the White House.
Today.
Today.
Which is in this show, Les Gems.
I love that. We're going to hear that right now. I love that song.
There'll be work for everybody. Y'all better hear what I say. Every child will get a
I mean, yes. Wow. Woo. I mean, you can tell everyone that we're exhausted up here. But we are so full of energy, we could go on and on and on. William Mickey Stevenson, you are, in the eyes of all your fans, and in the eyes of God, the one, the only A&R man that counts with all of us. I bless you for coming on and sharing your story with us, because I am so proud of the fact that you're sitting here with me now. And I'm not going to cry because my mascara runs, honey. So it ain't ever going to happen. But my heart is like bursting with joy. And I thank you for everything you have done for all of us. God bless you. God bless everything that you're going to be doing, because I'm going to be sitting in the front row in with that play, and I'm going to be moving and shaking. Thank you so much.
And we're going to help put a woman in the White
House. In the White House.
Oh,
yes. God willing.
Yes.
Thank you, everyone. It's been fabulous. We'll see you next time. I'm going to have my fling. I'm going to live until I die. The blues I lay low, I'll make them stay low. They'll never trail over my head.